say that these are combinations that are probably particularly efficacious to look at. Venetoclax was mentioned before in the lymphoid malignancies. The track record in AML is not as good yet. As a single agent, it was tested in relapsed and refractory AML, and it really was quite modest. It resulted in remissions in about 6% of patients, and sort of combined remissions and remissions in complete blood count recovery in roughly 20% of patients. But it looked somewhat modest. But what's really sort of gets a lot of buzz are two trials that are currently ongoing that have sort of updated data presented at several of the meetings over the last few years. And venetoclax is combined with either low-dose cytarabine or azacitidine or the cytarabine. And what's interesting about these trials, and these are not randomized trials, these are basically phase 1-2 trials, is that what's reported is a quite an impressive remission rate with these combinations in the magnitude of 60% to 70%, which seems to extend across sort of the cytogenetic range of patients. And at least when you look at the crude survival curves that are reported, they look quite encouraging. Granted, these are selected patients, it's not randomized, but it looks quite interesting. And the buzz is that the FDA is looking at this drug towards the end of the year as a potential approval in AML. So sort of switching briefly to ALL, again, thinking about what's new and trending, I came up with three things. One is, certainly there's an increasing realization of this entity, Philadelphia-like ALL, that is important to test for. It's difficult to test for, but maybe important to test for prognostic purposes, and maybe increasingly so for therapeutic purposes. There's three drugs approved, and unlike for AML, where the drug approvals, I think, mostly influence the upfront treatment, in ALL, the drug approvals really influence the treatment of relapsed refractory ALL. And a third sort of area that's very much in focus is the idea that you direct your treatment based on post-treatment markers like MRD, and sort of modulating your treatment and intensity based on success or prior treatment. Just like one slide on this entity of Philadelphia, like ALL, it's an entity that was recognized initially based on gene expression profiling, where it was recognized there was a disease entity that looked just like Philadelphia chromosome ALL, except it didn't have this canonical BCR-ABL mutation. It's now recognized that this phenotype is associated with a bunch of genes that are recurrently mutated. And they all sort of, though there are many of them, they all seem to affect activation of tyrosine kinase pathways. And there are several of them that are quite common in many patients. It's in children not very common, but in adults it can be seen in up to like 30% of the patients. So it's an entity that definitely will be seen. And what's important is it really has poor prognosis and is associated, not surprisingly, with a poor prognosis, leukemia, persistence of MRD after treatment. So far it is difficult to test for because gene expression profiling is not a simple test, that when you do mutation testing, you really have to test a bunch of mutations for it. And in some degree it's maybe academic, but it starts influencing treatment in that for some of these mutations, there's a notion that maybe tyrosine kinase inhibitors may still provide a benefit, even though the class of BCR-ABL mutation is not there. And for other subsets, JAK2 inhibitors seem to have perhaps some efficacy in it. So that's something that's currently under active investigation and may not be ready for prime time, but hopefully soon. So the three drugs that I want to briefly highlight, really they change the relapse refractory treatment setting. One's inotuzumab, ozumamycin, which is essentially Mylotarg except that it targets CD22. The approval was based on a randomized study with about 300 patients where the drug really has resulted in an impressive remission rate of 80% compared to about 30% when conventional chemotherapy is used. SOS and VOD in about 10% of the treated patients. But it could be a good drug to debulk patients and maybe set them up for treatment with this drug, blinatumomab, which is a bispecific antibody that sort of connects the binding domains of CD19 and CD3 in a small molecule and connects T cells with ALL cells, activates T cells and gets them to lead to apoptotic cell death of ALL cells. The drug was initially approved in the relapsed refractory setting based again on a randomized study of about 400 patients where the remission rate was about 40% with this drug compared to a range of 15-20% with conventional chemotherapy. The drug doesn't prolong survival and event-free survival by a few months. But I think the drug is really particularly interesting in the MRD setting where the initial buzz came from, but now there's a more mature study reported out in over 100 patients where the drug was given for patients that only had MRD level disease. In about 80% of those patients, you can induce an MRD negative remission. And in doing so, that seems to be associated with better survival estimates later on. So the toxicities are noticeable in that, at least in the MRD setting, grade 3 and 4 toxicities occur in about a third of the patients. Compared to intensive chemotherapy, it seems overall about the same, but there's some unique toxicities to consider. Those are cytokine release syndrome and neurologic toxicity, which are by and large very quickly reversible, but they can be dose limiting and sometimes dose may need to abbreviation of the treatment. And the drug's expensive as another noticeable toxicity. And sort of just the last word on CAR cells, and we heard before CAR cells, this is certainly the paradigm of CAR cell therapy. Targeting CD19, this is where the CTL019 and the target is, and this is where the drug's approved. It's approved for young patients, younger than age 25 or 26, with second relapse of ALL, and that's really based on experience in children, young adults, where in this setting it induces MRD negative remissions in about 80% of patients. And sometimes the drug can be detectable, or T cells can be detectable for quite some time after treatment. Similar, I think to me, this is sort of a more intense side effect profile, but it's very similar to what the bispecific antibodies do. They're now grade 3 and 4 toxicities in about 3/4 of the patients. Cytokine release syndrome in 3/4 of the patients, and neurologic events in about a little less than half of the patients. Again, it's an expensive drug. There's a lot of ongoing debate about how to use it and what to do with transplants later on. But sort of just to sort of summarize, I think this is really an exciting time for acute leukemia, where we're learning more biology-wise. We now have highly curative treatments that are chemotherapy-free. We have several new drugs to work with, both in AML and ALL, and I think we're going to learn in the next few years maybe how best to use them. And I do think we're sort of leading the way in these adoptive cell therapies that allow sort of making exploration of diseases as well. With this, I'll stop. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Walter. It's a really great talk. I invite next speaker, Dr. Rondelli, our own Dr. Rondelli, to talk about India.